Hello, I'm João Carlos Fonseca, Principal at the International Public Sector Accounting Standards Board, the IPSASB. Welcome to the first focal webinar of 2019, IPSAS 35 Consolidated Financial Statements. This webinar will provide an overview to the key features of IPSAS 35 and answer some common questions related to its application. Our webinar today will cover seven aspects related to IPSAS 35. The introduction, the scope, economic entity, control and involvement with other parties, accounting requirements, investment entities, and disclosures. At the end of the webinar, I'll cover the main takeaways of this webinar. IPSAS 35 Consolidated Financial Statements was issued in January 2015. Together with IPSAS 34, Separate Financial Statements, IPSAS 36, Investment in Associates and Joint Ventures, IPSAS 37, Joint Arrangements, and IPSAS 38, Disclosures of Interests in Other Entities. As we will see later in this webinar, these IPSAS are very much related and, therefore, it is important to know how they interact and their main concepts. The effective date of IPSAS 35 is January 1, 2017. IPSAS 35 is drawn primarily from IFRS 10, Consolidated Financial Statements. It is therefore an IFRS-aligned IPSAS. However, there are some differences from IFRS 10, such as terminology and definition of binding arrangement, more guidance on non-financial benefits, and public sector-specific illustrative examples. Let's see first what is the scope of IPSAS 35. The first question that we need to ask is whether the entity is a controlling entity. If it is not a controlling entity, then IPSAS 35 is not applicable to that entity. On the other hand, if it is a controlling entity, then we need to ask another question. Does the controlling entity meet all the conditions in paragraph 5A, B, C, and D? If yes, the controlling entity need not present consolidated financial statements. If no, we need to know whether the controlling entity, that is an investment entity, is required to measure all of its controlled entities at fair value, through surplus or deficit, according to paragraph 56 of IPSAS 35. If yes, the controlling entity shall not present consolidated financial statements. If no, the controlling entity shall prepare consolidated financial statements applying IPSAS 35. However, there are some important exceptions to the previous decision tree and specific situations to be careful. The first is the exemption in paragraph 5 of IPSAS 35. Does not apply where the information needs of a controlled entity's users would not be met by the consolidated financial statements of its controlling entity. The second is that if an investment entity has a controlled entity that is not itself an investment entity and whose main purpose and activities are providing services that relate to the investment entity's investment activities, it shall consolidate that controlled entity. The third is that a controlled entity with dissimilar activities from the controlling entity is not excluded from consolidation. And the fourth is that public sector combinations are excluded from IPSAS 35 and are within the scope of IPSAS 40 public sector combinations. Let's take a look now at the three main concepts that are in IPSAS 34 to IPSAS 38. The first concept is control. An entity controls another entity when the entity is exposed or has rights to variable benefits from its involvement with the other entity and has the ability to affect the nature or amount of those benefits through its power over the other entity. Thus, an entity controls another entity if and only if the entity has all the following elements: power over the other entity, exposure or rights to variable benefits from its involvement with the other entity, and the ability to use its power over the other entity to affect the nature or amount of the benefits from its involvement with the other entity. And when assessing whether it controls another entity, an entity shall consider all facts and circumstances. The entity shall reassess whether it controls another entity if facts and circumstances indicate there are changes to one or more of the three elements of control stated earlier. The second concept is joint control, and it means an agreed sharing of control of an arrangement by way of a binding arrangement, which exists only when decisions about the relevant activities require the unanimous consent of the parties sharing control. Therefore, an entity that is a party to an arrangement shall assess whether the binding arrangement gives all the parties or a group of the parties control of the arrangement collectively. All the parties or a group of the parties control the arrangement collectively when they must act together to direct the activities that significantly affect the benefits from the arrangement. For example, the relevant activities. Once it has been determined that all the parties or a group of the parties control the arrangement collectively, joint control exists only when decisions about the relevant activities require the unanimous consent of the parties that control the arrangement collectively. This also means that in a joint arrangement, no single party controls the arrangement of its own. A party with joint control of an arrangement can prevent any of the other parties or a group of the parties from controlling the arrangement. The third concept is significant influence, which is the power to participate in the financial and operating policies decisions of another entity, but is not control or joint control of those policies. It is important to know that if an entity holds a quantifiable ownership interest and it holds directly or indirectly through controlled entities, 20% or more of the voting power of the investee, it is presumed that the entity has significant influence, unless it can be clearly demonstrated that it is not the case. Conversely, if the entity holds directly or indirectly through controlled entities less than 20% of the voting power of the investee, it is presumed that the entity does not have significant influence, unless such influence can be clearly demonstrated. A substantial or majority ownership by another investor does not necessarily preclude an entity from having significant influence. Given the importance of the control concept, let's take a look in more detail the three elements of control. Regarding power, an entity has power over another entity when the entity has existing rights that give it the current ability to direct the relevant activities. For example, the activities that significantly affect the nature or amount of the benefits from its involvement with the other entity. However, the existence of rights over another entity does not necessarily give rise to power for the purposes of IPSAS 35. For example, an entity does not have power over another entity solely due to the existence of regulatory control or economic dependence. Regulatory control does not usually give rise to power over an entity for the purposes of IPSAS 35. However, when regulation is so tight as to effectively dictate how the entity performs its business, then it may be necessary to consider whether the purpose and design of the entity is such that it is controlled by the regulating entity. Economic dependence alone does not give rise to power over an entity for the purposes of IPSAS 35. An entity may be able to influence the financial and operating policies of another entity that is dependent on it for funding. However, a combination of factors will need to be considered to determine whether the economic dependence is such that the economically dependent entity no longer has the ultimate power to govern its own financial or operating policies. Regarding benefits, an entity is exposed or has rights to variable benefits from its involvement with an entity being assessed for control when the benefits that it seeks from its involvement have the potential to vary as a result of the other entity's performance. Regarding the link between power and benefits, an entity controls another entity if the entity not only has power over the entity being assessed for control and the exposure of rights to variable benefits from its involvement with the other entity, but also has the ability to use its power to affect the nature or amount of the benefits from its involvement with the entity being assessed for control. This means that the existence of congruent objectives alone is insufficient for an entity to conclude that it controls another entity. In order to have control, the entity would also need to have the ability to use its power over the entity being assessed for control to direct that other entity to work with it to further its objectives. An entity's investment in another entity determines which accounting applies. For a controlled entity, it applies consolidation accounting. For an investment in an associate or joint venture, it applies equity method. For a joint operation, it is accounting for assets and liabilities. If it has significant influence, it applies the equity method. If it has lack of influence, then it applies IPSAS 29-41 or other IPSAS as appropriate. In all cases, disclose in accordance with IPSAS 38 and other relevant IPSAS. Entities with controlled entities or investments in associates or joint ventures may present separate financial statements in accordance with IPSAS 34. For us to better understand how the concept of control applies in practice and its relationship with the concept of economic entity, let's take a look at the following example. Entity A controls entity B and C. Entities B and C control entities D and E and entities F and G, respectively. The economic entity encompasses the controlling entity and its controlled entities, as shown in the elliptic figure. Okay, we have covered a lot of ground so far in terms of the main concepts on consolidation. Let's dive now into some common practical questions that arise from these concepts. The first question is, is there a need or not to consolidate central banks? Well, an assessment needs to be made whether the legal framework that governs the central bank in the specific jurisdiction gives rise to control by government. For example, in the UK, the central bank is controlled by the government. However, in other jurisdictions, this might not be the case. The second question is, should a jurisdiction with three levels of government, federal, provincial or state, and municipalities, consolidate? In principle, no, but there may be exceptions. In normal circumstances, the federal government does not control the lower level of governments if they have autonomy on their operating and financial policies, unless there is an agreement that gives the federal government de facto control of the lower level of government. For example, a financially distressed municipality signs an agreement with a federal government relinquishing control of its financial and operating policies in exchange of financial assistance and thus helping to meet the fiscal targets of the general government sector. In other countries, the lower level of governments might be under the control of the central government, depending how centralized is the decision-making process of the financial and operating policies related to those lower level of governments. Now, let's turn to another important topic on accounting requirements. The main consolidation procedures are: combine like assets, liabilities, net assets equity, revenues, expenses and cash flows. Eliminate investments in controlled entities. Eliminate balances and transactions between entities of the economic entity. If necessary, adjust to conform accounting policies. If necessary, adjust for significant transactions between financial statement dates. Identify non-controlling interests in surplus or deficit and net assets and equity. There are two approaches to consolidation. The first one is to consolidate the whole group of entities at the same time at the top controlling entity level. The second approach is to consolidate bottom-up. The whole group consolidation means that you apply the consolidation procedures seen earlier to all entities, irrespective of their relative position in the economic entity. For example, in this example, you consolidate entities A to G in any given order. Bottom-up consolidation means that you apply the consolidation procedures first to entities B, D, and E, and C, F, and G. Afterwards, you apply the consolidation procedures to entity A and the resulting economic entities of B and C. Let's look at an example of consolidation procedures. Government transfers 100 to a department. Government debits expense 100 and credits cash 100. The department debits cash 100 and credits revenue 100. The department purchases an asset for 90 and pays salaries of 10. The department then transfers that purchased asset to a controlled entity. The controlled entity recognizes asset and revenue of 90. When consolidating, only the transactions outside of the square are to be captured in the economic entity, and the transactions between government, department, and controlled entity need to be eliminated. Now, let's see the accounting requirements for acquisitions, disposals, and loss of control. Revenues and expenses of controlled entity are included from date of acquisition. Revenues and expenses included until date control ceases during reporting period. Gain or loss reported on disposal of controlled entity. If control ceases, controlled entity accounted for as a financial asset. IPSAS 35 has specific guidance on investment entities. An investment entity is an entity that obtains funds from one or more investors for the purpose of providing those investors with investment management services. Has the purpose of investing funds solely for returns from capital appreciation, investment revenue, or both, and measures and evaluates the performance of substantially all of its investments on a fair value basis. An investment entity that is a controlling entity measures an investment in a controlled entity at fair value through surplus or deficit in accordance with IPSAS 29 or IPSAS 41. Except if controlled entity that provides services related to the investment activities. An investment entity determining whether an entity is an investment entity by assessing all effects and circumstances. An investment entity discloses the significant judgment and assumptions made in determining that it is an investment entity, unless it has all the following characteristics. It has obtained funds from more than one investor. It has ownership interests in the form of equity or similar interests. And it has more than one investment. Regarding the accounting for a change in investment entity status, when an entity ceases to be an investment entity, it shall apply IPSAS 40, public sector combinations, to any controlled entity that was previously measured at fair value through surplus or deficit in accordance with paragraph 56. the date of the change of status shall be deemed the acquisition date. The fair value of the controlled entity at the deemed acquisition date shall represent the transferred deemed consideration when measuring any goodwill or gain from a bargain purchase that arises from the deemed acquisition. IPSAS 38, Disclosure of Interests in Other Entities, provides the guidance on disclosures. The entity shall disclose significant judgments and assumptions made, and information about its interests in controlled entities, joint arrangements and associates, structured entities that are not consolidated, non-quantifiable ownership interests, and controlling interests acquired with the intention of disposal. The question number 3 is, how are the valuation methods of inventories, depreciation, amortization, revaluation of assets, in case different entities use different measurement bases? Well, when consolidating, the controlling entity will need to adjust the accounting policies of the controlled entities to the accounting policies of the controlling entity. This means that the controlling entity will need to adjust all the recognition and measurement requirements of the controlled entities to conform with accounting policies of the controlling entity. The question number 4 is, what is the role of the trial balance within the consolidation process, its structure and importance in the said consolidation process? The role of the trial balance is to assist in the consolidation procedures by identifying and quantifying the elements of the financial statements that will need to be included and or adjusted in the consolidation. Regarding its structure, it is important to have the information on assets, liabilities, revenue, expense, net assets, equity, results, and related parties. Because of the information that it provides, the trial balance is very important in the consolidation process. The main takeaways of this webinar are: IPSAS 35 applies to controlling entities, but with some exceptions. It is important to distinguish control from joint control from significant influence in the type of interests in other entities. The economic entity includes the controlling entity and the controlled entities. Eliminate all transactions and balances within the economic entity, and adjust the accounting policies of the controlled entity to conform with the accounting policies of the controlling entity. Thank you for viewing this webinar. For further information, please visit our webpage www.ipsasb.org. Goodbye.